So in this video, what I want to show you is the names of all the members that make up a warframe, and in the process, a or my preferred construction sequence, or the way I go about putting it together. So this is our completed warframe. I've chosen this one because it has most of the members in it, and here are all the names. We'll go through these individually shortly. And I'll repeat this slide at the end, but if you want to, you can pause and have a look at that one. But anyway, let's kick on. So, as I said, I'll do this in the way that I would normally construct the frame. So, to start with our frame, we need to start with our bottom plate and our top plate. So, obviously, these will be the horizontal members, one that runs along on the floor, another one runs along the top of the wall. Now, in between the plates, running from plate to plate, we're going to have studs. Now, there's about three, four different types of studs, depending, and the only thing that changes is the actual position of where they go. So, the first ones I throw in are the ones on the end, which are what we call corner studs. This set here are going to form the corner for the wall running at 90 degrees. This stud here will be where the two wall frames join. It may be at another intersection, or there could just be another wall continuing straight on. So, first studs I always throw in are the intersection studs. Then, while we do this, these two studs here, generally, we throw some blocking in because they're so close together. And we won't be able to get a noggin in, and you'll see that a little bit later. We throw in some blocks, about 300 mil, no shorter, sort of 300 mil minimum blocks, just to hold those two studs apart. Also gives us somewhere else to nail when we throw the wall on this end. Then I've put in my full length studs, or my window jam studs, that go on my window, and I throw in my door studs as well. These two sets of studs should be the straightest studs that you've got, because if you don't get nice straight studs in these positions, when you go to put your door jam in and your window, you're going to have a lot of trouble with your architrave trying to get your door into wind and that sort of thing. So make these sets of studs the straightest ones you can lay your hands on. You also notice at the top of the door where the trim is going to go, I've checked that in about 10 mil to take the window head. That's my personal preference. Okay, so they're the door studs. You can then throw in the remaining studs. So these are called the common studs. So on this wall, I've only got two common studs, which is that one and that one. But in other walls, I mean the entire wall except for the ones on the end, could be common studs. So common studs just run from top to bottom, same as all the rest, but they don't have a role, or they're not in a position to do anything. They're just going to transfer the weight of the roof. So that's all my full length studs. So next I'm going to put in my lintels. And to take my lintels, I need to put in a jam stud for my window. So here I've got a secondary stud called a jam stud, and my lintel sits on top of those. So these two studs here are supporting the weight of the lintel directly. And depending on the timber that you're using and the span of the lintel, you may need to have one, two, or even three of these studs underneath your lintel. Okay, so this is your lintel. This is just another piece of your framing material. So whatever your studs were, whether they're 90 by 35, 90 by 45, I just run another piece of that under the lintel, just so if you've got a lining on the outside, if you're doing weatherboards on the outside, it gives you somewhere to support or to nail off the weatherboards. Okay, so that's your lintel and your jamb studs. Your window sill trimmer. A lot of people just call it a sill, but it's a sill trimmer. It runs the width of the window. And we generally then, if we need a secondary stud under a head, we put a stud in between the lintel and the trimmer. And then later on, we'll put a jack stud under here to transfer the weight from the root, from the top plate all the way through to the floor. Continuing with our horizontal members, our door trimmer, door head trimmer in there. And then we can now, we've got all these horizontal pieces in, we can put in our jack studs. So any stud that doesn't run from top plate to bottom plate, that's a little bit shorter, is referred to as a jack stud. So got one above the doorway here. These doorways are generally sort of 800 to 900 wide, so that's wider than our standard spacing. So we have to put a jack stud in there. And as I said before, jack stud continuing that load path for that secondary jamb stud. Continuing with our spacing underneath the window, and another one on this side. And above the window, I've actually got another three jack studs that are there to just fill in the gap if we actually have that gap. The other option is to move this lintel all the way up to underneath the plate, and then you can pack out these jamb studs underneath the lintel. A lot of framing companies do it that way. They just automatically put their lintels hard up under the plate, and then if they need to pack down from the lintel, they just do it. They just frame it out. These particular studs are just framing material on their flat. It's just quicker than trying to rebate a L shape out of this piece of timber to sit it over. And that just takes, once again, if you're going to put weatherboards on the exterior of this house, it gives us somewhere to attach our weatherboards to. Also for brickwork, if we've got to tie the brick veneer in, gives us somewhere to put our veneer ties on. So that's jack studs. And then we have our noggins. So the standard spacing for our noggins is 1 meter 350. And generally, what we do is we mark a line through the wall, and then we put one stud above the line, one stud, sorry, one noggin above the line, and one noggin below the line, so that we can just drive the nails straight through and we don't need to skew them. Just makes it a stronger job. Although in areas like this, becomes a little bit difficult, we have to skew. So yeah, noggins, not studs, noggins. Then we need to brace the wall. So what we do is we have to check that it's square, so we can measure from corner to corner diagonally. And if those measurements are the same, then the wall is square, and then we can attach a diagonal brace, such as this one. Now, nowadays they're commonly made of a perforated metal, but in the old days they were made of timber. As you can see, it was a pretty tight fit to get this actual brace in. The preferred angle for a brace is 45 degrees. You can't lay them any flatter than 30 degrees, and you can't stand them up any steeper than 60 degrees, otherwise they lose their effectiveness. So this wall was a little bit tight, but if we couldn't get a diagonal brace in, then we can always use what they call a sheet brace. So this is just a specially made sheet of ply, or it can be a sheet of hardboard, or there are fiber cement products out there that's actually made as a sheet brace, and it's nailed to the frame, and it doesn't need to be a certain width. You just cut it to suit your stud work. And we generally try and keep our bracing on the external side of the wall so it won't interfere with any internal linings, or obviously if we're going to put a wall into this intersection. We don't want to have our brace between the two walls that are joining. Otherwise, we'll throw our building out by the thickness of the brace sheet. So that's it. There's our wall constructed. Once again, there's all our names.